So this is day two, and yesterday we talked about mostly overview kind of things, motivational things. So we had issues such as cognitive radios and in general wireless communications, and diversity was something that we were talking about, and I think it generated a lot of discussion, and you were thinking about various ways of diversity. But essentially what happens is that wireless medium is a very tough medium, and therefore there is a lot of interference. So there are many ways that, and you have to use them at the same time. Like error control coding, for example, is one way of combating interference. So there are many things, and you have to use them all at the same time in many ways, and you want to use your resources wisely. Yesterday there was some discussion about that you have to pay for it, basically diversity. You're sending things more often, so there is overhead and so on, but it's, as I said, there is no free lunch. You have to basically, if you want higher fidelity, more accurate results, then you have to pay for it, send things more. Or in error control codes, you have to have parity check bits or whatever else that you add, etc. So that's what we were doing. So now I guess we I still haven't completed, I guess, day one, so I will continue. There are four or five more slides here, so let's continue. So I was pleasantly surprised to know when you were talking about what you are doing, half of you said there you're working on spectrum sensing. So what that means is I should sit down and let you tell everyone else what spectrum sensing is, but I'll try to sort of talk about it, but I might call upon you if you think you have something to add. It's okay. You can tell the rest of the people some nuances, some fine points about spectrum sensing. So cognition, it did involve analyzing the radio scene, and what that means is that as we said, there are licensed channels, so you have those channels assigned to licensed users or primary users, and a lot of the times they are not being used. So that is when secondary users can opportunistically try to use the white spaces. So that was the general idea. But how do you find where the white spaces are and when they are available? So that's where the spectrum sensing comes in. So this is the cognition part, or analyzing the scene part. So that's what this thing does. Essentially what you need to do is you need to listen to any RF transmissions. And so one thing that we can do is, so obtaining, I think yesterday I was standing down here, so let me get down here. It feels like I'm up there somewhere. Awareness again means finding out about your surroundings for the purpose that you are looking at. In this case, the purpose is to find out the RF scene. So RF scene, about the spectrum usage and existence of primary users in a geographical area. So as I was saying, that you want to know, like if there are multiple primary users, so you want to see if any one of them is not using their channel, so that you could maybe utilize it. So that's what you want to do. This kind of reminds me of advanced things that one can do. Some years back, there was, you may have heard of an agency called DARPA, Defense Advanced Research Project Agency. So they, in the US, they sponsor a lot of these cutting edge or revolutionary quote unquote projects and ideas. So there was a project that they had, I forgot the name of the project, but they had to do something like this for, let's say, a city. So it was, I guess, for urban environments or and so on. So it was mapping of the radio scene essentially. So what that means is that, let's say that it being military, so I'll use the military kind of terminology, or maybe not. Let's just say that you want to map Kanpur as a city, and this could be for any purposes, not for military purposes. So then you can take a vehicle with all sorts of RF receivers, and then you can go around in the city, drive around, and then what you could do is you could find out what RF transmissions are taking place, and these are your radio signals that you are trying to get. So so these RF signals would be cataloged, and you will have sort of a map that on such and such street I had some transmission. Now this transmission is some, you don't want to ask who it is, so from that signal you really need to infer or determine many things. What kind of signal is it, what kind of transmitter it could be. So it's not just saying whether the occupancy of the channel you are looking at, you are also perhaps, if depending upon your application, you are also perhaps looking at what kind of signal it is, what modulation it is using, etc. Other information about it. So from that then you can try to see if basically you will have something, and then you can utilize it for your purposes, whatever those purposes are, I mean civilian or commercial or military or something. So I think it was called radio map program, but it could be but the essence was this. So you not only you want to do radio scene analysis for just occupancy, which is our purpose, but one can and one many a times needs to find out more from it other than just saying is it occupied or not. Now as long as I'm on the topic, trying to find out if there is, I mean what is it, there are many problems that arise. So one problem that I kind of alluded to is that what kind of modulation is being used. They are not going to tell you, and modulation, remember, I mean we talked about QPSK and PSK and QAM and these kinds of things, and perhaps you know who uses that kind of transmission, so you will know, perhaps you can gather some information. I'm still on that same slide because I was I thought I'll just tell them the stories and so on. So so in this case, if you have to determine, so it would become a classification problem. Is it a QPSK signal or is it QAM signal, for example? And then you have to operate under a variety of uncertainties. So the timing will not be there, so time synchronization is not there, so that you have to account for. Frequency offsets are there, so you have to account for that. And many other things that you don't know, time of arrival, so time of synchronization, frequency, phase, so many such things. So and so mathematics can be used, so estimation theory that we'll talk about most of the day today, you will, I mean you have to utilize all of that in trying to solve real problems. So I mean I'll be covering only theory, but all of this is applied, can be applied, needs to be applied to solve problems. So I think just giving, I mean some motivational speech I guess here, that all the theory that we do, it is useful, and this is just a small problem, but this radio map program that I talked about, that was much, much more extensive, that you need to know where the transmitters are, what kind of signal they are saying, learn about the signal. So there is much more that can be done in radio scene analysis, but anyway. So after my long story, so there are many methods of spectrum sensing, and here we are just dealing with the sensing that is performed by cognitive radios. Okay, so then it can be posed as a detection problem. So tomorrow we will be spending our time on detection theory. Detection theory, the fundamental problem, so here is the binary hypothesis testing problem that is stated. So you are trying to detect the presence or absence of the primary signal here. That's your problem. But more generally, detection theory is nothing but the binary problem is something present or absent, or you transmitted one or a zero. So those are all binary detection problems. So hypothesis zero is just that y is equal to w. That means that the received signal is just noise, thermal noise usually we assume. And the other one is that signal plus noise. So you have to distinguish between them, that is it just noise, so that means there is no primary signal, primary user, or there is a primary user, so then so it will be H sub 1, so that presence. Okay. So that's the thing that you have to do, and then more advanced things it's that I was talking about, then it would just not be is it there or not, but who is there, what kind of signal is there. So those problems become classification problem or MRE hypothesis testing problem, where the possibilities are like QPSK 0, 1, 2 or 3, so those kinds of things. Now the performance of spectrum sensing is represented by the probability of error, probability of false alarm, and the probability of misdetection. So I guess on the next slide I do define them, but the idea is probability of error is just, I mean, the decision itself that you made a mistake. Probability of false alarm is that when there is no primary user and you say that there is a primary user, so that's a false alarm. And in your application, in your scenario, what would that mean? There is nobody, but you think that there is somebody, so you don't use it at that time, and so the resource goes is wasted. Basically it was available but you didn't use it, so that's a false alarm. In other contexts, if you are trying to rescue somebody from some disaster thing, and if your decision, if there is a false alarm, then you will send rescuers out there, but there was nobody to bring out, and so on. So those are the false alarm things. And the probability of misdetection is that when you there was actually something and you miss it. And so in that case, like in my evacuation or rescue thing, there was somebody who needed to be rescued, but you didn't send the people to rescue them. So that's the misdetection, and that is something that, I mean, again, there are costs and benefits and so on. And so when the systems are designed, I mean, these decision rules, which again, tomorrow we'll be doing just detection theory, but that's where, I mean, you will may need to assign costs and so on and optimize your system. Okay, so probability of error, as I said, I will be defining here. So again, tomorrow we'll see that there are many formulations for the detection problem. In one formulation, we need to know the prior probability. So here, probability that the primary is absent, which means probability of H sub 0 being present, is denoted as pi sub 0. And the probability that the primary is present or hypothesis 1 is pi sub 1. So these are prior probabilities. In some applications, again, you might say, how do I know what they are, etc. We'll address those tomorrow. But if you know them, then we use Bayesian formulation for the detection problem, and we'll spend time tomorrow. Probability of false alarm, I think I just explained it, that here you decide H sub 1 when H 0 was present, and the probability of this happening, probability of this event is your P sub F probability of false alarm, and in statistics it is also called type 1 error. So, another thing that I can tell you, I mean, so statisticians, they have been pursuing this under the names of statistical decision theory. In engineering, we call it detection theory. Hypothesis testing is another name that is used by folks. And there are many, many books in the statistics literature, and there are many, many books in the engineering literature. So, it is just the presentation and the way, I mean, the language, I guess, in two communities, they may be different, but we are talking about the same thing. So, they will call it a type 1 error, we will call it probability of false alarm. So, it is just that one needs to be able to use terminology in different areas. And so, another thing that yesterday I was telling you, that you have to get out of your little cubby holes and talk to others and establish relationships and solve big problems. So, I have to then, even though it is early, but I think my stories can start now, so that you do not fall asleep. But all of you did say you had a good night's sleep, so you will not fall asleep until about 12:15 or something, but anyway. So, sometimes, I mean, it gets difficult to work on interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary problems. And I will give you one story, which I guess a few of you will appreciate, but if you appreciate, please laugh. If not, then just assume that it was, you were supposed to laugh. So, some years back, we had a major project it was sponsored by Environmental Protection Agency, EPA. So, we were looking at smart buildings and the way, so basically air quality inside rooms. And the way we got involved was that there is sensing and control aspects to the problem. So, if I want to control the environment, I need to know, again, map. So, it is kind of related, I needed to map the inside of the room. Let us say if I want to do temperature control, that it is an office building and there are cubicles, and people in those cubicles, somebody wants higher temperature, somebody wants lower temperature. So, you need to have sensors, and then you have to map, just like the radio scene here that we are mapping. And then you need to control, you need to have a distributed control thing, so that you can have, so we designed a building. I have other slides and other presentations where I could talk about it, but so distributed control, so that you can actually implement this, what you decide, that this person wants 20 degrees centigrade in his or her cubicle, this one wants 23 and so on. So, individual control and whatever. So, the story goes like this, the sponsors, the people, project monitors, they were chemists, and so just trying to tell them, so first year we were presenting our things and we said, you know, we have this great algorithm, and what is an algorithm? I said, oh, okay. So, anyway, year two, they come and then we again say that we have this outstanding algorithm. Oh, what is an algorithm? I said, last year I defined for you what an algorithm is. And then they said, are there any chemists in here? I'm just picking on, what I was mean is that somebody who is not in this area. So, I'm trying to talk about interdisciplinary thing. So, they say algorithm, okay, anyway. So, then year 3 they come around, that day I was not there. So, my students were presenting things and I had told them, do not use technical jargon, do not do this, but sometimes students don't listen to you, or maybe most of the time, whatever. So, they said, you know, we did this and we were using particle filters. Then they say, what size particle? So they're filtering of particle sizes, and particle filter in our case is to represent probability density random like distributions, and then doing that. So anyway, so one has to overcome these. So I'm sort of not saying that don't do multidisciplinary work, I'm saying do it, but these will be the hurdles that you will need to cross. So these were sponsors, but then talking to your mechanical engineering folks who are doing buildings and stuff, I mean, it'll take time, but then you can solve big problems. So that's basically what you need to do. So probability of misdetection is deciding H0 when H1 is true, and it's also called type 2 error in statistics. And the probability of error is weighted sum of these PF and PM, and that's the probability of error. Okay, so then this MIMO, I think many of you, they were saying that you are working on these kinds of ideas. So here is just a picture that I want to show that people are using MIMO for cognitive radios, and somebody here yesterday said that on handheld receivers you have two antennas now, and base stations have eight or whatever. So it's coming and it's happening, and so that's basically it. It is saying that people are using spatial diversity. MIMO is nothing but spatial diversity, and what it does is it does reliable spectrum sensing and signal transmission, and it's efficient in terms of required sensing time, because if you have multiple antennas, so you are able to get more information, quote unquote, and then you are able to make a decision more, I mean, faster or more quickly. And this is spatial diversity. So, and that reference is just one reference, that's where the picture is from, but there is has been a lot of stuff on MIMO and massive MIMO and all whatever, all these big things, which again, I'm not familiar with everything, of course, but that's what is happening in the field. Okay. Finally, I think this is the last slide in this thing, which was there a question here? Or? Okay. We talked about spectrum sensing and two, three slides back, and this is just a picture that I took from that paper. So here it is, I guess, there is only single antenna there and multiple here. So the idea is sort of to say that you can put multiple antennas there too. So so this is what, single input, multiple output, right? Yeah, it, one can, and I'm sure people have, because so lots of people have, I mean, so the things come in waves. So if one starts working in something, then there are hundreds of papers on that, and then the wave goes down, then another wave starts, and so on. So it's, I guess right now the wave is massive MIMO, right? That's the wave currently. And I'm not on a on it, I mean, I'm not really working on these things, but the wave is out there, and I'm just standing on the side and watching the wave. Okay, so yeah, I mean, certainly people, I mean, this is just an illustration. Okay, so in spectrum sensing, the implication in two, three slides back was that there is, I mean, you are a secondary user, and you are trying to determine if the channel is available or not. But there are many issues, many things that happen, and that because of that, the quality of the decision may not be as good as you may want. So probability of error or false alarms and missed detections and so on. And the reason for that would be there is noise uncertainty, fading. We spent a lot of time yesterday about on fading, shadowing, etc. So you want to improve the quality of your decision, and So this notion of cooperative sensing, which means that you employ multiple cognitive radios at different locations to sense the spectrum. So here is something that I guess here the application is cooperative sensing, but this problem of cooperatively solving detection problems, that is something that I have spent my lifetime on, basically 35 years or so. So that problem of distributed detection is something that I started working on 1981 or 82, before all of you were born, I still continue to do that. So it's that problem that you have a team. So in the well, there are. Anyway, I was just. Do this, but maybe the, I mean, Professor Sarkar is sitting back there. He was born before that. I know that, but others maybe yes or no, just before, just after. But many of the folks were born. anyway. So what was I saying? Yeah, so I mean, so the problem of solving decision problems, like team decision problems, those problems are important, and this is one application of that problem. So what I did was, I mean, solving the basic problem, and then many applications, sort of in the beginning you make simplifying assumptions, and then you keep relaxing those assumptions. So this afternoon I'll be giving a talk in the department, and so I will be talking about this cooperative decision making problems. However, for a long time people for analytical tractability assumed that the signals the signals at the secondaries, they are statistically independent, but that is not the case, because the scene, the presence or absence of the primary user, that is the same. So they are all looking at the same phenomenon, so naturally what they see is dependent or correlated. So last 5 or 7 years we have been working on relaxing that assumption and trying to do this problem with statistical dependence or statistically dependent observation. So I'll be talking about roughly that problem is it 5 o'clock today, I guess, or something. So I mean, in the EE department. So anyway, so the thing is that it's collectively they are trying to determine whether there is a primary or not, and an important thing is that that we need to realize that there could be issues, and something that we will talk about day 4, where when you are solving these problems cooperatively, some people could be malicious. They could be give you false data. So we'll spend a lot of time talking about solving this spectrum sensing problem in the presence of malicious nodes that falsify their data, and their motive could be just having fun or their motive could be that they somehow want to mislead the thing so that maybe they could use the channel, whatever. So we'll talk about that, the same thing on day 4. And so there are many reasons that you want to employ the team of cognitive radios to try to decide whether you have the primary channel is available or not. And this is nothing but a type of spatial diversity, because your CR is here, I am here, so you are kind of getting signals at different places, so you are doing that. And the definition of diversity that we had yesterday, so cooperative diversity cooperative diversity for spectrum sensing, the same thing we can define. This is what we had yesterday, and P sub star is that star could be false alarm or misdetection or probability of error. So you can use any one of these, put that, and that will be your measure of diversity. So that's what we had yesterday. And as I said, that this is what people had done most of the time, that about 10, 12 years ago when people started looking at, defining this, they were looking at the asymptotic regime, or when signal to noise ratio goes to infinity. Some people are looking at more reasonable, meaning the finite SNR regime, and trying to define diversity for that point. And as I said, it is something that's of interest, and there was a recent paper by Ardway and some other, probably his student, and we basically have a much more general thing which has not yet appeared in the literature. So these kinds of things, defining diversity measures and so on, that's important. So for instance, if I have something not necessarily here, but if I want to utilize, somebody here talked about medical imaging, different like CT and MRI and so on. So if you have multimodal signals, that's like you're providing diversity. So one is able to see maybe bones better, the other one can see tissues better, and so on. So there is diversity. How does one go about defining diversity for such problems? And those, I don't think we understand the problem how to define it, because it's the ability to see, different features of the scene, medical scene, would be that, as I said, bones and this and that. So it's an open, ongoing problem how to define diversity for general things, such as what I just talked about, MRI and CT. How do you define diversity? Those kinds of things are important. Okay, so summary of day one. As cognitive radios, we talked about history, definition, and applications. We talked about channel models, time component, and frequency. We talked about additive white Gaussian noise channels, which is a very popular model that people use to derive performance measures and so on. And then when we add fading to it, then the performance really goes down. Then how do you improve that? And diversity is one method, but you need to have other things like error control coding, as I talked about, and other ways to manage interference. So this is what we have done so far. And the references for this part, Say and Vishwanath is one, and some of these pictures that we got are from these two papers. So, but most of the theory comes from there that we talked about. Okay, any questions, quick questions about this part before we move on to estimation? You have to be a little loud. A good question. It's not always true. So if you really have prior information, so if you are solving the problem of maybe is there a disease, so you are maybe examining a patient or something, or crops, then disease does not occur as often as not having the disease. So yeah, the prior probabilities do not have to be equal. That could be digital communications. Yes, zeros and ones are equally likely most of the time. But other than that, no, you need to have prior information, and that is why there is this debate whether using Bayesian methodology for detection, that we'll talk about tomorrow, is really worthwhile. Should one do that or not? Because the question is, how do we know the prior?
How to distinguish between the, like if a sender is sending consistently ones and zeros. So sir, you are sending zero, that means you are sending nothing. So in spectrum sensing, if you are, in that phase, transmitter is sending zero. So it will be misleading to the secondary user that is he not sending or is he?
So the question is, sending a zero does not mean not sending anything. That is only on-off keying. But if you are using binary phase shift keying, then you are sending plus A or minus 1 or plus 1. So no, something is being sent, and then on the basis of that you decide. But even if one was using on-off keying, then it would be so off would mean that whatever channel is not available or something. So it's basically let's think about BPSK or those kinds of modulation schemes where you send something under both hypotheses. So then, yeah. Okay. So I think any more questions we will do later. So now let me switch to the next part. Okay, so today, meaning that this second part, we'll spend time on basics of estimation theory. And I will spend a little bit of time once again motivating that what we do today is useful. So initially I do that, but one thing is that I tell you that just trust me, believe me, but you know, you have run into lots of salespeople who say that, oh, this machine works well, or this car is the best, and so on. And actually the used car salespeople, that's the usual thing that one uses, that this runs well and everything, but you bring it home and it doesn't. So I'm not that, so I'll give you some motivation a bit more, but so I'm not going to say completely that trust me, it is useful. So it is useful. It will be a dense presentation, lots of equations, lots of things. So you have to just bear with me, and you have to always keep in mind that this is all for a good cause. It is useful, that's why we are doing it. So that's what will happen. And as I said, there are lots of details. Some of those details I myself may not know, because I'm just we put together a lot of things. So we'll just keep going, and then look at these things together, and keep on moving. So motivation, early part, then introduction to estimation, then Bayesian estimation. So their prior information will be needed. So wherever Bayes comes in, prior information will be needed. We'll talk about non-Bayesian approaches, Kremer-Rao lower bound. This Rao that we have, he's a very famous statistician. Many things he did a lot. So he's a very, and he is in his 90s. He's still alive, and he still travels to conferences and so on. I believe he lives in Bangalore now. He left it, and I know that his daughter lives in Buffalo, New York. So he comes there, or used to come there. So because some of my colleagues have gone and visited with him while he was visiting his daughter. I know, so he's probably 95 or whatever. He's up there in age, but a top-notch, world-renowned statistician, let's put it that way. Maximum likelihood estimation, linear estimators, and so on. So lots of these things we'll talk about. So motivation, I think I have given you enough motivation, but it's never enough. You keep talking about why we are doing things. So the cognitive tasks, I mean radio scene analysis, which we just talked about under spectrum sensing, channel state estimation and predictive modeling, CSI, I guess somebody brought up, so that's what we are talking about, transmit power control and dynamic spectrum management. So we need to power control, I think you will talk about, so later on it will come up, I mean as we go, I don't think I am talking about it, but you need to estimate things, and that is when you can control, I mean yeah, estimation is useful for that. Need for parameter estimation in these two, channel state estimation, radio scene analysis, and use of, anyway I just said all this. Under radio scene analysis, we need to estimate interference temperature, so we will spend some time doing that. And what you need to do is you need to estimate the power spectral density of interference at the receiver. So power spectral density meaning that if somebody is interfering with me, how much and what and that kind of thing. So that's what this is about. And detection of spectrum holes, which again we have talked about it over and over again, that we need to know when there is an opportunity for me to go and use the channel. So that is the spectrum holes, and that is detection theory, which is tomorrow. Okay, so estimation, channel state estimation, the kinds of things basically you estimate, and then the CSI is fed back to the transmitter, so they can adjust their things, power control or whatever. So they can decide their strategies, their actions based on what the estimate is. And then prediction of the channel capacity for use by the transmitter. So how much is available? So I mean fine, there is a whole spectrum hole, but then how much can it handle? It's a finite amount, so just predicting that, and power control. So finally, selling point, the used car salesman saying this is a very good car. So important aspect of cognitive radios. Okay. Now, the parameter or point estimation. So what we have is we have a certain parameter that is associated with your communications. It could be, for instance, phase. So if you want to estimate the phase, then that's a parameter that you want to estimate, and you want to do that as accurately as possible. So naturally you want to do a good job, the error you want to have as little as possible. So we will need to define what error is and how do we penalize the process, so that means cost functions and so on. So we need to the goal is trying to estimate the parameter as accurately as possible. As I said earlier, Bayesian approach is something that people use, but then there is a non-Bayesian thing. So under the Bayesian formulation, which so the first part will be Bayesian. So the non-Bayesian part is where you will find that I'm working, reading with you and work, I mean doing things here on the fly. Bayesian, we've been doing for a long time, I personally, that is. So in the Bayesian sense, what happens is that assume that the parameter is a random variable. So there is an associated PDF with it, and so that is what is used in doing whatever we do. So it's a random variable, and we need to know the probability density function. In the non-Bayesian, the parameter is assumed to be unknown. So we don't know it. If you knew it, then there is no problem to begin with. So there is no problem, it's unknown, but there is no PDF associated with it. So we don't assume that it is a random variable. We say it's an unknown constant. So that is the non-Bayesian. And the other thing is parameters could be static or they could be dynamic. And you can think of the possibilities how things like fading, as we see, things keep changing. So when you are estimating parameters associated with that, then that would be a dynamic situation. So you have static problems, parameters, and dynamic parameters. Okay, so let's get into Bayesian estimation theory. And from now on, for the next couple of hours, it will be lots of equations, lots of math. But if you suddenly start having too many equations, then you raise your hand and I say, look, it's for a good cause. We are trying to do radio scene analysis, and so it is useful, and then we go back to equations again. So it's, I mean, it's under basic mathematics, and we need to do this, and we need to know how to actually implement, perform things, functions that enable cognitive radio and so on. So the observations are y. They belong to set gamma. Y is parametrized by theta. So what we have is y has an associated distribution p sub theta of y, and theta is the parameter that controls, or yeah, I guess is a part of that PDF. So it could be that we'll see that, yeah. And this parameter is to be estimated, and it belongs to this set. The prior for this theta is assumed to be known. So we know p theta of theta, and this is where the Bayesian thing comes in, that we assume first of all that theta is a random variable and we know its PDF. Now you might say that, well, how do you know it? So that again is the debate, Bayesian versus non-Bayesian. In some cases, when you don't have any information, you assume uniform distribution. Well, it could be anywhere between 0 and 1 or something, and then you do. But again, it may or may not be a good model, so then, but that's what you have to live with. The cost function associated with the estimate, theta hat, so hat indicates it is an estimate. And it is C of theta hat y theta. So theta hat is the estimate. It is a function of y, that means the observations. So you receive the observations, you do something with them. That doing something is your theta hat, processing some function of the observation. Maybe you add them, or you take the average of them, or do some other fancy function. So that is, so it is a theta hat of y, and this cost is something that I'll give you some examples now, but looking ahead, I mean, what squared error and all these kinds of things. So how do you penalize, how do you define the cost function? Now Bayes risk is defined as by averaging over the distribution of the observations y and the parameter theta. So r of theta hat, which is the risk, and risk is the cost of estimation. And the cost of estimation is, so we define the cost C here, but then you need to take the expected value of this, so average cost. Okay, so the average cost, so this is for one realization, so you take the average, and this is what one needs to minimize. You want to minimize the Bayesian risk while design, so that's the optimization. You want to design the best estimator as accurate as possible, which means that as small a cost as possible, average cost. So that's the, I mean, formulation, meaning that this is the setup. And so r of theta hat, then this we had earlier. So then here you do first, you do the theta given y. Y is the observation. So expected value of your cost. And by the way, I guess I didn't say it was expected value with respect to theta. So it is E of theta given y. So you do a conditional expectation, and then you do the expectation over y. So this is actually this here. So once again here, as I said the other yesterday, that I need to make this assumption that you are very familiar with probabilities, random variables, PDFs, expectations, and so on. If not, then you just assume that some things are being done which are relevant and which have again, that need to be done. But this is, like today, you will see a lot of this, and don't get discouraged. Tomorrow, we will be doing detection. So today, it is an infinite hypothesis problem, which means that the hypothesis is that the value of the parameter is 0.93 or 94. Yes, tomorrow it will be, is it 0 or 1? So then we would, you can say, simplify or whatever. They are both statistical inference problems. Finite number of classes or infinite number of values. Okay, so then I guess what I am saying is that in order to find theta hat, you can actually minimize this, the inner term, and that theta hat can be found by minimizing this term. Now, types of cost functions, there are three that we will consider, and I'll take one at a time and then derive the estimator. One is minimum mean squared error, which minimizes the squared error between the estimate and the true value. The other is mean absolute error, so absolute error between the estimate and the true value, and uniform cost function, and I'll define it in a minute. And the thing is that these different cost functions will give different estimators. In some special cases, they are all the same, but in general, they will give different results or different estimates. First one, this is the mean squared error. So here what is happening is your cost is the C that I had said. It is defined as theta hat minus theta whole square. And here is your error epsilon. Epsilon is that your true value was this and your theta hat is here. So in the distance between them, that is your error. And then what we are saying is that square of this error is what you are doing. So you are, so this is the cost, it is like the parabola, it is epsilon square. So that's what the cost that we assume under MMSE. I could have done straight line, which will happen hopefully soon, but this is a very popular cost function, MMSE. So, using this, what we said was minimize the expected value of the cost given y. So, cost is squared error. Given the observation, so this is what I am actually doing. This is the cost square given the observation y, and this what it is saying is minimize this and the value at which the minimum occurs is your solution. So this terminology, this notation simply is saying that the argument of this, which means the value of that theta that minimizes this, is your estimate. Is that clear? The notation. So you will see this notation over and over again, I think. But the main thing is that arg min, so that value of theta that minimizes this is theta hat MMS. So the cost here, e of theta hat y minus theta square, you take the square. I was just going to say that all of you are so advanced now. When I was doing this, I don't know, maybe I did this in high school or something, taking squares, and you do it in first grade now, right? I'm just saying that you've done it all the time. So this is just your regular standard. I mean, take the square theta hat y square minus 2 theta hat and et cetera. So this is e of theta square given this. So it is just do the square. And that was my attempt at some humor, but some of you got it, some of you didn't, but anyway, that's fine. So this is a quadratic function of this. So you differentiate with respect to theta and equate to 0, and this is what you get. So there are maybe a couple of steps missing, but that's the idea, that you take this, you are trying to minimize this, open it up, take the derivative, set it equal to 0, and that's what you get. And this is what you get. This is the conditional mean of theta given y. So if you did not have your observation y, then since you knew the prior PDF, you knew the, you could find the mean of that. So that would be your estimate based on prior knowledge. When you take, when you get an observation y, then if you find the mean, having seen, having obtained the observation, that hopefully changes your mean. So that's the knowledge that you got from the observation, which improves your estimate. So this is the, this is the a posteriori, I guess. So you, after the observation, find the mean of theta, and that's your estimate. So conditional mean of theta given y equal to y. So prior and posterior, that's, I guess, what I'm trying to talk about, that you had some prior knowledge. I mean, you can just think, okay, what is the mean of this? That's the estimate. But then, but you're going through this process, you are doing this because you want to do a better job. So this is the better job. So the, hopefully this is more accurate because you observed it. So that's the MMSE estimate. The second cost function, as we discussed, is the mean absolute error. So the squared function was this. Here it is the absolute error. So the farther you go, epsilon increases. This is increasing in a linear fashion. Now you might ask which one is better and so on. So this again is your decision. You need to decide how much you want to penalize errors. Here it is linear. If the error is more, then I want to linearly increase the cost. Square is you want to penalize errors more, and therefore you, we had the other one. You might want to say, how about 10th error to the power 10? Fine, I mean, you can do that. There will be some function which will really penalize that. I mean, you better not make errors. So it's that kind of thing. So it, you decide and which one is better and so on. It depends upon your needs, your applications and so on. So here the estimate is arg min e of absolute error given the observation. So remember, what did we have? We had expected value of the cost, whatever function previously we had, square of this, given the observation. So we want to do that. So we can write, this is something you already know, the mean is, anyway, let's just move on here. So expected value of the absolute error is 0 to infinity, probability that the error is greater than x given y equal to y. So we can write this as, so what we are doing is it's because of the absolute value, we are breaking it into two parts. And so it is, it can be written as theta hat to infinity, probability of theta greater than t given y, and minus infinity to theta hat this. And then this is a differentiable function of theta hat. So you differentiate with respect to theta, equate to 0, and you get MMAE estimate, which is the median of theta given y equal to y. Why is it median? Because the area under the curve on this side is equal to the area under the curve on this side, and that is defined as the median. Okay. So I think you can look ahead and you can think about those distributions for which mean and median are the same. So when I said that in general the cost functions, different cost functions will yield different results, but what are the conditions under which they give the same result? Well, the mean and the median, if they are the same, then you will get the same result. So is there any guess which, what kind of distribution, I mean at least one distribution? Gaussian. Okay, there is a question here and I stopped him because I wanted my full screen time. I didn't want to miss out on that. So, yes. Say that again. I guess I'm not getting it. Here? Oh, yeah, I mean it's, so yeah, okay, these are dummy variables, yeah. So, yeah, it should, I guess we should have kept it as x or put t here, yeah, they are the same, it's a dummy variable. Many a times what I would have said in this case, I was just testing you if you catch it or not, but no, it should be the same, yeah, it's a dummy variable. Okay, so this is the median of the posterior distribution. Remember one other thing, it's the posterior distribution. Given the observation PDF, given the observation, then find the mean and the median. And there is one thing remaining, which is the mode. So we need to do that too. Okay. So the third cost function is something which is defined in this manner, that if you estimate and your estimate is within a certain window, let us say, then you say it is as good as the correct estimate. If you are outside this window, then we say it's not correct, and we in this case assign the same cost of 1. So what it means is that you are saying that as long as my estimate is within in close neighborhood, I mean if I'm close, it's a close enough versus not close enough, it's that kind of a decision. That kind of a cost function. So that's what it is saying, that if you are within like minus delta to delta, meaning error is smaller than minus delta, it's between minus delta and delta, fine, perfect estimate. Otherwise it's equally bad. So that's what this is saying. So in this case, the minimizing the uniform cost yields the MAP estimate. MAP is maximum A, oh yeah, it says there, maximum A posteriori probability, MAP. Okay, so for an estimated theta hat, the posterior cost given y equal to y, so this is what we have been writing. It is the probability that the error is greater than delta given y equal to y. Remember, if the cost was 1, if you are out, if your absolute error is greater than delta, then it's 1. So that's the probability of this, that's what your expected error is. Okay. And this is, you can write it, turn it around 1 minus the probability over that inside thing. So 1 minus that. So what I have is, so this, the average cost is 1 minus this. And I wanted to minimize this. So how do I minimize this? If I look at this, I maximize it. So if I can maximize this, I'm minimizing this. So this thing is, so what you are doing is, it is nothing but the area over minus delta to delta of your a posteriori probability. So what you are doing intuitively is, you start from one end, find the area, and you keep traveling through the thing. Wherever you got the maximum area, you stop right there, that's your solution. So that's what you are doing. So you are maximizing the posterior probability. So this is what you had, and you are searching over this region as to where you get the maximum area in this 2 delta. So that is what it is. So MAP estimate is the mode of theta given y equal to y. So we got mean, median, and mode under the 3 different cost functions. If you use other cost functions, fine, I mean, you will get other things. But these are typically the 3 under Bayesian estimation popular cost functions that people use. Okay, so now let's work on an example. So we'll apply the 3 things to this distribution function. Typically, when I teach the course, I use Gaussian, but here it is exponential. So what we have is the parameter space, which means that since it is exponential, it's 0 to infinity. Observation space is the real line. Observation y has the following conditional probability density function. So p theta given y is given here, and y is greater than or equal to 0. That's the exponential distribution. You don't take negative values. So it is 0 if y is less than 0, and the parameter here is theta. So what you want to estimate is this theta, the parameter of the PDF. Now, it is Bayesian problem that we are dealing with. So we need to know the prior distribution for theta. So we are assuming for this example that theta is also exponentially distributed with this density. W of theta, which is alpha e to the minus alpha theta. Now here alpha is known. Remember, we said we need to know the prior density function. Knowing the prior density function means knowing it completely, including the parameters. So theta, alpha is known. Okay, so we have the problem set up that you have the this is the PDF of the observation, and this is the theta, the prior density of that. So before I go to the next page, what should I do? We'll go through the mechanics, but up to this point, what did you learn, meaning what is the next step? And let me just ask somebody, I think that's a good thing, and I don't want to ask people sitting in the front. So whoever is the farthest in the room, okay, somewhere in the middle, so let me go to you. Yeah, so what should be the next step? How should I proceed? I know the prior density, I said that we know this. So this is the observation, and this is the prior, I mean just in words, where are we heading? I don't mean to put you on the spot, but it's just that I want people to be engaged. So, okay, anyone, any volunteer, yes. Yeah, basically find the a posteriori PDF. So, because then once we have that, then we need to find its mean, median and mode for all the three things. So, we need to find, yeah, base, yeah. So, we need to find the a posteriori density. Ah, Bayes rule, yes, that's the one. So, posterior density, actually you have the things in front of you, so one could have done this. No, I don't suggest that. I think you should be just thinking along, like almost all of you are doing. I mean, it's just that there may be one person who is not doing that, and I don't want to find out who it is. No, all of you are doing it. Okay, so then, oops. So, posterior density is what we need to find. So, that means that, so W of theta was the, let me see. Yeah, so this is the prior density W. So, then we need to find W of theta given Y and use Bayes rule. I have forgotten Bayes rule. I studied it 50 years ago or something, whatever. You know what Bayes rule is, right? Yeah, so we are just using that. So, in the denominator, it will be what? The joint density, I guess, or something like that. Okay, so as long as you know what it is, we are in good shape. So, we can just write. So, this is the alpha. So, let's go back here. So, we knew the W of theta, we know P theta given Y. So, then we are just writing the joint and then divide by. So, we are integrating out theta, which one? Yeah, it's marginal. Yeah. So, this is what you get and then the W theta given Y is 0 otherwise, I mean because of the fact we are dealing with exponentials. So, anyway, so all of you are with me as to how we got this. Now, the thing was, if I am doing the MMSE, I need to find the mean. If I am doing MMAE, I need to find the median. If I am doing the last one, uniform, whatever it was, then the mode, those three things. So, finding the mean is theta, this, I mean 0 to infinity theta times PDF, and if one does it, I assume this is what one will get. So, you get 2 divided by alpha plus y, and this is just a hint, I guess. I think this is what you will do in the afternoon. So, okay. So, this is the MMSE estimate. The median can be found by solving this. Theta is continuous. Solving this means what? Once again, median was that find that point for which the area under this side and this side is equal. So, that is what is going on. Find that point so that from here to the infinity is 1/2. So, couple of steps given here and ultimately what you get is T0 divided by alpha plus y. Here it was 2 divided alpha plus y. Here it is some T0 and T0 is the solution of this equation. So, the estimate is different from MMSE by a scale factor. So, the form is the same, the constant, the scaling is different. There is no need, I guess, to go through what the algebra and so on. So, some steps are given, some work you may need to do and last one, oh, even the Bayes theorem we give here. So MAP estimate is finding. So this was the find the a posteriori density, which is W theta given Y, and find the point at which it gets its maximum. So once again, my thing that I am going through, find that point where I have the maximum, which since it is continuous, nice properties, that's where, I mean, it will be at the maximum value. So there are some details given here, which says that take the log that makes life easier. So I guess in detection theory, tomorrow you will see again that like Gaussians and exponentials, if you take the log, then things become easier to solve, and they are monotonic, and therefore if you are maximizing the log, or whether you are doing it directly, they give the same result. So to make things convenient, you take the log of this, so that becomes arg max p theta y w theta here, arg max of log plus log, then differentiate with respect to theta, and then equate to 0, and you get 1 over alpha plus y. So the first estimate was t divided by alpha plus y, second was some t 0 divided by this 1 divided by alpha plus y. So in this case, they are all different, but scaled. So I mean, they have the same form, but the scaling is different. So Gaussian would have given you the same, because if the posterior is Gaussian, then mean, median, and mode, they are all the same. Okay, vector parameter estimation. So in this case, whatever we just learned, it was for a scalar. Everything can go and be applied to a vector. So in this case, the theta is not a scalar but a vector, so it will lie in R to the m. So if we had two parameters, theta 1 and theta 2, then we are dealing with theta 1 comma theta 2, which is in a two-dimensional space. That's all what this is saying. If you had m parameters, then you have an m dimensional space, and theta is the point in that m dimensional space. The cost function is given here. So c sub I theta I hat theta I. So basically, I mean, it's the generalization from going from scalar to vector. And the individual costs could be mean square error, mean absolute error, or uniform error. So straightforward extension to the vector. Oh, this one here. Yeah, I guess they should be not bold. Yeah, so the question is that theta I bold means that it is a vector, but it is, yeah, it is an element of the vector. Yeah, yes, you are right. Yeah, all over, I guess that's what is happening. They should all be lowercase thetas. Okay, so I mean, you again have similar estimates: conditional mean, conditional median, conditional mode, and the procedure is the same as for the scalar case. One more useful cost function that in the vector case that is useful, and where, I mean, it's a generalization of MMSE, this introduction of A. In the scalar squared error case, it was theta minus, I mean, square of theta minus theta hat minus theta. But here, a more general thing could be that maybe different elements you assign different weights. So maybe estimate of one parameter is more important than the other and so on. So that's what you can do. So if A is a symmetric positive definite matrix, so this is a more general thing, and this cost allows for joint weighting of errors in different parameters, and this is a desirable feature for some applications. So maybe if you are doing like one parameter is more important than the other, then you put more weight on it and so on, and when you jointly optimize it, sort of gives you that kind of estimate. Okay. And the, I mean, you get the using this cost function, I mean, you get the conditional mean, but the Bayes risk will depend on the choice of the matrix A, the risk itself. So anyway, this is just an extension. Okay, this is a place where we can either take a break now, or don't get up yet. So no, you can get up. So if we let's find out if we should or we shouldn't. So from now on, it will be more heavy, and it'll be like I'll be just doing cataloging of many different cases and many different types of estimators, and I'll stop at the slides and let you look at them, stare at the slides, and so on. But it's one after the other. 5 minutes. Yeah. Okay. So let's take some questions at this stage, maybe one or two or three or four or five, whatever. So as soon as the chai wala comes, I guess we can take a break. So is there any question that did not let you sleep last night? I mean, you lost sleep because of something that was bothering you? Yeah, so the question is that about definition of diversity, whether it is equal to the number of independent paths from transmitter to receiver. So, I mean, in the early part that I talked about, L, the number of paths was the thing, was the diversity index, but then I defined the diversity measure D in terms of something else. So, yeah. Does one define diversity at there or for the whole system? Okay, so I think, so the question is that the terms transmit diversity and receiver diversity, so I think maybe what they are saying is how many antennas are there, probably. That's just my feeling. That transmit diversity, they are saying there are two antenna elements on the transmitter. I think that's what they mean. But again, I'm just, that's my conjecture. Anything else at this point? Otherwise, I mean, I can move on or.
In this case, we are estimating various parameters. How are we going to apply it for the channel states?
Patience. So, towards the end, I think I'll come back and talk about a little bit, but once again, the emphasis, my emphasis is give the theory. Applications, I'll just point to that, but details you will have to get into. So the question was, how are we going to apply estimation theory to problems? And anyway, so yeah. But so I will, there is a little bit that I'll at least point towards saying that this is what you need to do. So for instance, I mean, if channel state, if we say it's a Rayleigh channel, then you need to estimate its parameters, Rayleigh distribution, so what is the parameter and so on, so those kinds of things. But patience. Okay, all right. So let's continue with the estimation theory. So we have talked about the Bayesian part. Now I'll get into non-Bayesian part, and here, as I said, we will be, I mean, I'll go through many models, many things, and I'll just keep on going and see how things go. The Bayesian part, okay. So we'll do the non-Bayesian, and as I said, I mean, we will continue with a number of ways and number of models, and towards the end, some things on how to, I mean, some applications and so on. But this may be a rapid fire kind of thing that I'll do now. So in the case of Bayesian, what we had was we wanted to, I mean, we had the prior information. So we model the theta as a random variable, and we knew the PDF. Now theta will be basically an unknown constant. So the goal is to minimize the squared error cost with respect to the distribution of y given theta. Notice I'm not saying we know p theta of theta. That means the PDF of theta, we are not saying we know that. So in this case, then r theta of theta, so this is the average of the squared error, that's what we want to minimize. But then we cannot expect to minimize this uniformly for all theta. So that means that if you, I think I lost it again. Is it, I don't know, movement or whatever. So, but are you getting your thing? Sometimes, okay, anyway, so you will have to bear with this fading phenomenon. Sometimes you will hear me through this, sometimes directly line of sight, sometimes through this. So anyway, so maybe it is movement or something that's causing it. So mobility was the thing. So we are practicing our things that we have just studied. Okay. So we cannot, so I mean, if the parameter theta is over an entire range, so then this thing may or may not be able to minimize this. So there are many things that people have done, and one of the things that people try to talk about is that maybe the estimate that you get is unbiased. So bias is an important property, let us say, of estimators, and this condition is called unbiasedness. What it is saying is that your parameter, the value is theta, and the estimate that you get, e of theta hat given y, so this is again the estimate based on the data, the mean of that, the expected value of that, is equal to the true value of the parameter. So that is unbiasedness. So then this could be or would be one condition that maybe that I want to find an estimate that is unbiased. Now you do remember, mean does not really, is not everything. So mean may be the same, but if the variance is so broad, then in that case, what you will get is, I mean, it's not acceptable or satisfactory and so on. So in any case, so but unbiasedness would be one condition. So one type of estimator is minimum variance unbiased estimator. So this one will minimize the squared error and unbiased. So what you will see is various types of estimators, and this material is coming from Steve Kay's book. So I mean, you have the thing later on. I personally do not use his book, so I don't use this terminology, and I don't cover, when I teach detection and estimation, I do not cover this. So he in the book goes through a number of things, and which you will see as we go along. I personally use books by, like, Van Trees is one book, which is a very old book that consistent with me. So I use that most of the time when I teach detection and estimation course. But Steve Kay, he has done a good job, two volumes and all that. So now here, originally, my idea was to do a lot of math, and I mean this finding MVUE, it is rather involved. So finally what has been done is that I moved this material as an appendix. So I'm not going to be doing, so the slides are there. So here is my used salesperson, car salesperson pitch. Just trust me, I will just go through it without defining, I mean going through factorization theorem. So couple of slides just say that there are processes, and I will not really do much of it. An example I'll do, because it was going to be quite a bit of heavy math, so I decided to move it back. But let me just talk about what sufficient statistic means, that term. And but I will not be doing, I'll just touch upon this very briefly without going into details. So sufficient statistic is something that when you receive the data, then if you can capture the necessary information that you need from that data to perform your inference, whether it is estimation or detection that we'll have tomorrow. So that is called sufficient statistics. So somehow if you take your data and from that you can compute something. So tomorrow it will be likelihood ratio, for example. So that captures everything and you don't need to know the rest of it. So that is called sort of sufficient statistic informally. And then for this part, there is, as I said, much, much more detail that you use factorization theorem and then determine if this is complete, find a function that yields an unbiased estimator, or evaluate theta hat as expected value theta tilde ty, and so on. So there is quite a bit of work, and I encourage you, if you really want to learn, please do it on your own. But it is a fascinating subject, and by the way, this is again same Professor Rao, and Blackwell is another famous statistician. So so the procedure is here, and I'm just going to let you look at it. So use factorization theorem to find the sufficient statistic, which I am not saying how you do it. Determine if ty is complete, I'm not saying how to determine it. And find the function that of ty, unbiased, etc. So let me just move on. As I said, this one I'm not going to do. By this example, I think some of the concepts will become clear, but they may or may not be completely clear. So that is what I'm saying right up front. So let's say that the problem is this: y of n, these are the observations. And you have A is something that you want to estimate. So it is an unknown constant. I'm not saying that it's a random variable. It is an unknown. It is a fixed value. And you observe this in the presence of zero mean Gaussian with variance sigma square. So that's the noisy observation that you have. In this case, and by the way, you take n observations. This might remind you of all the physics experiments that you did in middle school or high school or whatever. Basically, take lots of readings and then find the average, that kind of thing. So these are the observations, and each time that you perform the experiment, it is noisy, or there is some randomness involved. So you have different errors, and then you just find, one experiment that I think we did was finding little g. You did some experiment and you did it a few times, and then you took the average or something. So it has been too long, I don't remember other experiments, but that's like your estimation. So sufficient statistic in this case is actually the summation of your observations. Two ways to find the estimate A hat: find any unbiased estimator of A, say A tilde equal to y1, and determine the mean here, and find some function g so that A hat, so that's the procedure that I talked about, is an unbiased estimator of A. to determine A hat, so this was one of the things that one can do. using the properties of Gaussian distribution, A hat would be A plus this quantity. So basically, I mean, A hat is nothing but the average, and there is a theory behind it, which I'm avoiding to make life easier. And the variance of this estimator is sigma square divided by n. So this one MVUE, so I think the main message that I think that I want to convey is that this estimator is, you're trying to find the unbiased estimate. So the mean is good, is equal to the value of the parameter and minimum variance. So the spread that I was talking about, that is minimized. So in this case, the variance of A hat is sigma squared divided by n. The second approach, again, I mean, details are at the end of the notes, that we need to find some function g so that this is an unbiased estimator of A. And by inspection, g of x is x divided by n, which yields this. So, so again, I mean, many a times it is, I mean, it could be even an art, meaning that, like, observe by inspection, what function is it that will give us the estimate and so on. So, I guess, I mean, 2-3 slides, as I said, I really did not cover it. I had much more there, but then I decided to move it back because when later on, when you see the back, I mean, meaning slide, whatever, at the end of it, you'll see what I mean, why I moved it. Okay, now I guess I'll get back into things which is rather important. So yesterday I did mention that when I was talking about Shannon and all that, that you want to find achievability results, which means that knowing something, what is achievable, what are the bounds on performance. So this, in the same spirit of things, what you want to do is you want to find for estimation problem what is achievable, what is the minimum that you can do. So that idea of bounding the performance is what we are doing now. Let's do it and you will see what I'm talking about. I'm heading towards Kramer Rao lower bound. So in this case, suppose theta is an estimate of parameter theta in a family P theta, and following regularity conditions hold. So I'm in deep fade again. Maybe it will come back. Yeah, it did come back. So I think it is maybe the angle or something. And that's what fading is, right? I mean, different thing. Okay. So let's say that the following regularity conditions hold. And this is something that I guess as a novice, I never checked. I mean, like when I was using Kramer-Rao lower bound, I will just say, okay, fine, do this. But I never really looked at the conditions under which results exist. So that is a message for you that do not use things blindly. You need to understand, the results that you have, they were obtained under certain assumptions or conditions. So make sure that those results apply. Because it is very easy, I mean, one can fall in the trap that, this result, that result, doom, and then you come out with something. But then if the conditions were not true, assumptions are violated and so on, then that your results are wrong. So you basically do not blindly do things. Let me give you another story. It's not related to your course, but it is related to my talk later this afternoon. I'm using something, again, it's not related, so it's not in the notes, and this is just something that you may find fascinating. There is a theory called copula theory. And this copula theory, what it does is it allows you to construct joint probability distributions from marginals, because almost all of you know joint and marginal distributions. So in certain instances when we are talking about some of your dependents, so I mean if you know marginals and if the random variables are independent, then we can take the product and we get the joint distribution. However, if there is dependence, then if you use the model of taking the product, then that's, I mean, fine, you have ignored or you did not take into account dependence. So that model does not accurately reflect the phenomenon. But anyway, so there is something called copula theory that allows you to construct joint distributions and then you can learn the model from data. So now the thing is that this theory has been used a lot in economics and finance. So people, utilize it, and then what they do is they come up with predictions and forecasts of stock market and all these kinds of things. So what happened was, there was a Wall Street meltdown 10, 12 years ago, I guess. So people blamed that meltdown on copula theory. And they said that it gave bad results and that is why our predictions were wrong and we ran into that situation. So it wasn't the theory that was wrong, it was the people who were applying it, they were not applying it correctly. So they were using wrong assumptions, wrong models, actually multivariate Gaussian copula or something that they used. So that resulted in wrong predictions and Wall Street meltdown. And it was not the theory but the people who didn't apply it right. So I just again, I mean, so a talk that I gave at some place, I mean, somebody just brought this up that, oh, copula theory, it's useless. I said, no, it's not useless if you apply it wisely. So the story that I'm giving you is again stressing the fact that use models, use results wisely. That's why you have things up here. Don't blindly do things. So I have been using copula theory for my problems in signal processing and whatever, lots of things. So if I use it wisely, I'm able to improve results, system performance. And I keep telling my critics that about copula theory that no, it was not responsible for Wall Street meltdown. I mean, it was a major news. I mean, if Wall Street meltdown means the whole, I mean, it's all global these days, right? So it affects everyone. So now when you go back and talk to people outside this room, then say that now I know why there was Wall Street meltdown and this instructor was not the one responsible for it. I mean, it made, if you go and look for like Google, search copula theory and Wall Street, you will get articles and reports and so on. So I'm not making it up. That's okay. So basically what I was saying was that you have these regularity conditions. They need to be, finite, like variance of theta hat should be finite, and you should be able to take the derivative of your E of theta hat. So if these things are there, then variance of theta hat of Y is greater than or equal to this quantity. And this I sub theta is another quantity here. And this is called, I of theta is called the Fisher information or Fisher's information. So this is an important result, and Fisher is another, was another statistician. So what you are noticing here is variance of theta hat. So theta hat is again the estimate, and the spread of theta hat, that is bounded by this, and that is a good result that you want to have unbiased if you can, and then the spread of that should be you should be able to know how much the spread is. So then the Kramer-Rao lower bound, so once again this is for the problem where theta is an unknown parameter, not a random variable. There are similar results for the Bayesian case, which I am not covering, and Van Trees, there is a gentleman, he in his book and in his, and he actually has a whole book on bounds for Bayesian and many things. So there are similar results for the Bayesian case also, but this one is for the case where theta is non-random and fixed. So if the second derivative exists, then the Fisher information can be expressed like that. And so if theta hat is unbiased, that is, that's the unbiasedness condition, then the information inequality that I had on the previous page is variance of theta is greater than or equal to 1 over I sub theta, and it is called the Kremer-Rao lower bound. So this is a major and very fundamental result in estimation theory. I mean, one of the handful of key results, this is one of them. So what it does is that it gives you, I mean, an I sub theta you can find from here, and it gives you your performance is greater than or equal to this quantity. So basically it bounds it. Now let me just talk about the fact that the bound is, you look at it and you find the performance of your estimator, but there are many other ways that bounds can be used. It can be used as a heuristic for, designing systems. So there have been many problems that my research group has engaged in, where we were designing systems and we were basically looking at this bound and then playing with this bound. So if I want to design a system where I know that this Fisher information or Kremer-Rao or lower bound, this thing, if I can do I maximize or minimize, but looking at this I can use it as a heuristic, because I need an objective function. If I'm trying to design a system, some sensing system or anything, then I do not have access to the actual estimate and so on. So then if I'm able to compute the bound, then I can use the bound as an objective function in my optimization. So once again, it's just that if it's not sort of, you're saying what does it mean and so on, just think of it as something that can be used for system optimization, and this is a heuristic. It does not characterize the actual performance, but it characterizes the achievable bound. So we have used it for a lot of things, and the Bayesian version of it would be the posterior Kremer-Rao lower bound, so PCRLB. So it is something, it goes beyond just estimation theory. It can be used in system design and so on as a heuristic. So we have done a lot of it. And another thing that we did actually is that this is an offline bound, by the way. So because it is all based on the densities, etc., that are, you assume that they are known. But in resource allocation, for instance, in a dynamic situation, it would be really good if you could have an online bound. So any observations, what you have is you are basically random processes, and what is actually happening is a realization of it. So people, you can work with these averages and so on, but if you could include the actual thing that is happening, actual realization, then your thing will be even better, because you know the exact situation. So scene analysis, like we said, so that is actual thing. So something that we have done is, again, looking at it, computing it online posterior Kremer-Rao lower bound, and then using it to manage my our resources in some way. So I don't know. I mean, I'm pretty sure that in cognitive radio field, it's also it could be useful. But my application was more of sensor fusion and tracking and those kinds of problems. Okay. Anyway, enough about selling this thing. This is a very important and a fundamental result. So finding this as an example, same example that we have. So y of n is a plus wn, and wn is a zero mean Gaussian with variance sigma square, and we want to determine the CRLB for theta equal to this parameter. So density of the observation, so p theta given p theta of y is p, I mean basically it is a Gaussian, and there are n samples. We have assumed that they are independent, so it is a product of these Gaussians, and which is written in this form. Now, so notice, I mean, something that I said, I mean, if the phenomenon was such that these time samples were not independent, then this would not be a good model and so on, but assuming everything is independent and so on. Take the first derivative, so it's a mechanics now, just do this, do that, it's a prescription. So you find the log of PA, because exponential densities, log makes it much easier. So you have this, differentiate again with respect to A, you have the second derivative, and this was needed here, second derivative of log. So it's just mechanics, just keep doing it, and then the CRLB is sigma square divided by n. And I guess we didn't do this, I removed the slides, that MVUE achieves the Kramer-Rao lower bound for estimating a constant parameter. One other thing that, again, it's not on the slides, I don't think so, is that CRLB gives you the best achievable bound. So if for an estimation problem you can achieve the bound, then that's the best, and that estimate is called efficient estimate. So so what it is trying to say is that MVUE is an efficient estimator for this constant parameter and Gaussian noise. So it's just, so if you can show that it is an efficient estimate, wonderful, that is the best that is one can do. So there are other such things also. Okay, so after MVUE, perhaps maybe it's intractable, or you do not have a complete sufficient statistic. So this was something, I mean, once again in material that I removed, that MVUE may not be possible or tractable all the time. So then maximum likelihood is used very, very often. Very often it is used. So we get to that. And the main thing that you do is you find a value of theta which makes the observations y most likely. So y is the observation that you have. Find that value of theta that makes it the observation most likely. So that's the intuition behind it. And it is, so this is the observation, and you are trying to make it the most likely, the observation to be most likely as a function of theta. So that value of theta that makes it the maximum. So maximizing this p theta is equivalent to maximizing log of this, and assuming sufficient smoothness of this, a necessary condition for maximum likelihood estimate is del theta log p theta of y, etc. Solve this, and what you do is you get, this is the likelihood equation, and the solution of this gives you the maximum likelihood estimate, ML estimate. You'll see that all over the place all the time. MMSE estimate for the Bayesian, ML for non-Bayesian, these are used a lot. Something that the it says compare with MAP estimator. So let's just, I don't think it is on the slides, but let me just, if you recall, let me go back and see if I have the MAP estimate here. So MAP estimate looked something like this, arg max p theta, so it was the a posteriori density, given why you are finding the maximum, you're maximizing it. Here it's just the p theta, so you don't have the prior in here. So basically, in MAP, you have two terms. One is this term, plus there is another term, plus which is based on the prior. So MAP, if you forget about the prior, that is ML, or ML, if you add prior information, then it goes to MAP. So the relationship between the two is that they are very similar. Except that in one case you don't have the prior density p theta of theta. Here, I mean, you don't know it, so you just maximize it in this manner. There, remember, it was we were trying to sort of search, and then we were trying to find the maximum of the a posteriori probability. Here we are, doing the p theta of y. We are maximizing that. So anyway, so they are related in that sense. Example of exponential random variables, and so f theta is our theta e minus theta to the power theta y k joint distribution, so that under independent things, so the joint is this quantity, just simple product, and the likelihood equation del del theta log p theta of y gives you this. Set this equal to 0 and you get theta hat ML to be n divided by the summation of y sub k's. So I stopped at this for a minute. Does it seem right? Because it normally I'm used to 1 over n summation of whatever data, but here we are, I mean, theta is, if we were estimating 1 over theta, then we would get that form, 1 over n divided by this. So this is correct. Yeah, it is correct, but it sort of, you look at it and it appears to you something is wrong, but it is correct. So it is, I mean, if you were doing, anyway, 1 over theta hat ML is what you normally would see. Yeah, so if you had Bernoulli distribution, and Bernoulli distribution is a discrete random variable, and IID Bernoulli with parameter theta. So f theta of yk is theta to the power yk 1 minus theta to this. So it is equal to 1 with probability theta and 0 with probability 1 minus theta. So what kind of situation this would be, that the Bernoulli trials, is that something you remember, maybe flipping a coin or something? Okay, it's coming back, I think, right? Okay, anyway, it's the binary random variable, flip a coin or do something with probability p, you get a head and tail and so on. So it's that problem. So joint distribution is, one can write, I mean, take the product of this and all of that, and the likelihood equation, you write this, and what you get is what the expected, I mean, like, this is the kind of thing you should get, right? So you do get it, which in the case of exponential looked wrong, but it is fine. And so then I guess you will find the maybe ML estimate for Gaussian distribution, and this might mean that you might have this problem this afternoon. Might, I don't remember. anyway, so basically, I mean, maximum likelihood estimation is something that is used a lot, you should know about it, and if you are in this field, I mean, you may see it often. I mean, if you get into research or even, implementing systems, that you need to find the ML estimate. Okay. Now, the next thing that we have here is linear estimators. So, in many cases, the estimator, so like for instance, MVUE, in many cases, we cannot find it, we may not know the distribution of the data, even if we know the PDF and so on. There are, issues, there are reasons why we may not get the optimal. So then, and this is true in many problems, that if you cannot find the best solution, then can you find something which is reasonable? So doing that reasonable thing is that here, what we are saying is that if we constrain our estimator to be maybe linear, then so from the class of all the estimators, I'm restricting that look, it's only linear estimators, so that's the subset of the entire list, entire set. So then within that, you try to find the best. So it's not optimal, it is suboptimal, and it's a reasonable thing to do. So once again, do not sell to your boss going saying that here is, you find a linear estimator and say, look, I found the best. Well, you found the best linear estimator. There may be other better nonlinear estimators, but they may not be computable. It may be difficult to find, etc. So it's, once again, do not oversell what you do. Something that you can find, you find it and say that it is the best in the class of linear estimators. And why did I go to linear? Because finding the optimum was computationally difficult or not tractable and so on. So that's, so it could be an adequate choice, etc. So that then brings us to the estimator called blue or best linear unbiased estimator. So what are some of the things that are in that are mentioned here? So first of all, it is unbiased estimator. So we know all about that, right? What is an unbiased estimator? It is the estimate is the average value of that is equal to the value of the parameter. So that's unbiased. So that is one good property to have. Now we are saying that the estimator is going to be a linear one. So I'm restricting. So it will be something like the data comes y1, y2, y3. I do some linear processing of that. And then I want to find the best linear processing. So that is what we are doing. So find an estimator that is unbiased and has minimum variance. Minimum variance. So finding that linear function, linear processing, which gives me minimum variance. And this is called blue. And it can be determined using the first and second moments of the distribution. So that is something. So what we want to do is it can be determined using the first and second second moments of the distribution. And here, complete knowledge of the distribution is not required, which is more practical. One question for you. Is there any, so first of all, is this statement true that, you know the first and second moments, and I'm saying complete knowledge of the distribution is not required. Are they consistent statements? A volunteer. So to specify the distribution, distribution of a random variable, is it sufficient to just provide first and second order moments?
Yes.
Some yes and some no. So maybe it's something in between. Maybe for some distributions, maybe it is sufficient. So what is or are those distributions? Gaussian. So Gaussian distribution can be completely specified by its mean and the variance, okay, but not others. So that's what this is saying, that if you know the first and second order moments, you really don't know the complete distribution unless it is Gaussian, then you know it. So that's what we are saying. So just knowing this first and second, and if the distribution is not Gaussian, then you do not know the distribution completely. Okay, so what we have is, we have the data set Y, distribution P theta. The blue, the estimator linear in data, is expressed as this. So linear processing or linear function is nothing but taking a sum of all the y sub k's appropriately weighted. So what we really need to then do is find the best set of ak's that will do the thing. So what we need to find are the best ak's that will minimize the something, the variance, yet, and it is unbiased, and the structure of the estimator is constrained to be this. So unbiased constraints, that the expected value of theta hat has to be theta. The variance of the estimator under this constraint is written as A transpose C A, and C is this, which is the square of the error, written in the form of, so this is the mean, so y minus the mean, I mean in the matrix form. So that is what we want to do, and to satisfy the unbiased, so I think there are some details that I am skipping. To satisfy the unbiasedness constraint, E of yk needs to be linear, so it is some S sub k of theta. So unbiasedness constraint becomes A transpose S equal to 1. So the problem then is theta hat blue is arg min A transpose C A. So this is the, you're trying to minimize the variance, or in this case, the vector, the matrix form. And A transpose S is equal to 1. This is the unbiasedness constraint. So so to solve this, this is a constrained optimization problem. One can use the Lagrangian multipliers method. Details I am not doing. And the result turns out to be that A opt is this, and the theta hat basically is, so this is your A opt, and times y. So this is the your blue estimate. So once again repeating what blue means, it is a linear estimate, it's unbiased, and it minimizes the variance. So MVUE was from the class of all the estimators. This is from the class of linear estimators, the best one. And what we needed to do this was the scaled mean S, and this is the scaled mean S, and the covariance matrix C. So that's what, so C is the second order information. There is the derivation also. I didn't realize that. So these are the details. I didn't remember that they were details. So let me quickly do this. I mean, Lagrangian multiplier method. So the variance is A transpose C A subject to constraint this using Lagrangian multipliers. So we want to minimize this. This is the unknown Lagrange multiplier. This is the constraint. You have seen this, right? Lagrangian multiplier method. Is it taught in calculus or somewhere else? Calculus, right? Just checking. So the gradient with respect to A, so del J del A is this, set this equal to 0 and solving you get A is minus lambda divided by 2 C inverse S. What is missing is this lambda is unknown. So this can be found using the constraint. That's what you did in that, right? I mean, the finding the unknown parameter, you get got went back to the constraint. And the constraint was A transpose S was equal to 1. So you substituted it back. And so lambda is obtained from this. So it's the standard thing that you have done, in your calculus course. I guess we have lost it again. So A opt, it is really a fading process, or I mean it's a time varying something going on. So the estimator then is, is given by this, and the variance is given by this. So again, details, it's good that there are, I mean, some steps that are given. It's now really getting challenging. One needs to design some real systems here to, okay. So the variance of the estimator is this. So this is like as an exercise, if you will, that things one can, how to derive it. So that's done. Now let's do an example here. The DC level and white noise problem. So we need to, so here instead of A, it became mu, but it's the same problem. You get n observations, W of n is zero mean white noise with variance sigma square. Note that we are not saying what the distribution is. If it was Gaussian, then we knew, I mean, like what to do and so on. So this is, we only are saying that we want to estimate mu, but we don't know. We know the first, I mean, the mean and the variance, first two order moments, but I don't know the PDF. So E of xn is mu, therefore we have Sn equal to 1. So S equal to, the blue will basically be this, where I is the identity matrix and the variance is this. So I'm just applying this to the, I mean, results to the what we had derived. So it just shows that one can use it and one can find it. And the variance is sigma square divided by n, which basically is a rule of thumb that you knew that if you take more and more observations, the variance goes down. So that's why you go for large number of observations so that you get lower variance. And that's again another thing that you do. I don't know how many of you have done like Monte Carlo simulations and so on. So in those, it is said that you have a large number of runs so that you can get, this is what you are doing, you are trying to reduce the variance so that the results you get is better, smoother and all that. Okay, next. Now this is Bayesian approach. We are going back to, so here what we want to do is linear minimum mean square estimator. So MSE was the Bayesian thing. So we went back to it. So optimal, here is the key thing. The MMSE that we obtained, it was the conditional mean, right? Conditional mean. But that could be nonlinear and so on. So then here the idea is that we want to do something which is computationally easier. So if I restrict the form of my estimator to be linear, then maybe it will be easier to compute or calculate and so on. So optimal are sometimes difficult to implement, maybe too computationally intensive to implement, and it may involve multidimensional integration, multidimensional maximization. So these are harder things to do. Now, for Gaussians, things are done more easily, but for other general distributions, we don't know. So when unable to make the Gaussian assumption, some other approach must be used. So let's retain that this criterion, but put a constraint that it has to be linear. So it is analogous to blue, which was a non-Bayesian. This one is something similar to blue, but in the Bayesian format. So it's an analog of that. So what we have is the data set is given here. Estimate theta based on y, where theta is assumed to be the realization of a random variable. So we switched gears. We were assuming theta was a constant unknown. Now theta is back as a random variable. What we want to do is find the class of, within the class of linear estimators, I want to find the best theta hat, which minimizes the MSE. So I need to know the A0 and A sub n's. I constrained the structure of the filter. So conditional mean was the optimum. But here I am saying I don't know what the structure, in general we don't know. So let's reduce the class of estimators to be linear, and within that I want to find the best. Okay. In case you are thinking again, we're doing this estimate, that estimate, remember I told you they are useful, right? None of you are saying what's going on, just one equation after the other, right? There is a goal, there is an ultimate payoff, right? Okay. So we choose the weighting coefficient such that we want to, so this is argmin of theta, so minimize this, that value of theta that minimizes this, but the structure of the estimator is this. Standard stuff, you expect that. So the objective function is this, because this is the structure of the theta hat. So it is nothing but E of theta minus theta hat square. Theta hat was this. Differentiate this with respect, and then set it equal to 0. And with that, you will get A0 is this. And I guess just trying to get this A0 out. So basically, performing the derivative and so on, theta hat is given by this. So this is now linear MMSE estimator, and the procedure is somewhat similar. Take the derivative, set them equal to 0, etc., etc. And these are details, what are C theta y, so it would be cross covariance matrix between theta and y. We know all these terms, right? Cross covariance, covariance, and all that. So CYY is, I guess, covariance, cross covariance, Y theta, theta Y, and so on. So it is part of your course that you did on random variables or random processes, or you did not do, but still you know what we are doing. So when you were taking those courses, I guess your instructors must have told you that have patience, these things will be useful. So they are useful here, and I'm still saying don't worry, these things are going to be useful. So it's just that you build up your knowledge, you keep on learning, and then you are ready to apply and build spacecrafts or whatever, all the fascinating things that you do. Properties of this estimator, it depends only on the first two moments of the distribution. A0 is included to allow for non-zero means of y and theta. If the means are zero, then you get a much easier, much straightforward estimate. So which is cross covariance matrix, CYY inverse and y. Very important thing, it is suboptimal, because you had the entire set of estimators, you constrained them to be linear, so it became a smaller set, meaning it's a subset. Within that subset, you are finding the best, but it is possible that the best is outside of that linear ones. For jointly Gaussian y and theta, this is optimal. So under certain conditions like this, it is optimal, but in general, it is not. It makes sense, right? Because you are searching for the best from a smaller subset, not the whole thing. Next is least squares estimation. So here we actually move on from the probabilistic methods to this is non-probabilistic. And you might say that why is that and all that sort of thing. So in, I mean, like, there are situations where you, I guess it probably, yeah, I mean, so basically there could be situations where you don't know the probability distributions and you maybe do not even want to know. So you want to just do something that makes sense. And there are people who I guess are in the camp of probabilistic methods, models. There is another camp which is non-probabilistic, which means I don't care, here is the data, let me just find the best estimate. I guess I'm looking at Professor Sarkar because his advisor in the non-probabilistic thing, so very strong and very vocal saying that probabilistic things are, anyway. So all of these were based on probabilistic models. And so now we want to do least squares. So we would like to minimize a least squares error criterion without any averages and all that kind of stuff. Now, it's well and good, but the disadvantage is that we cannot talk, say anything about optimality. We just say that we are doing something that hopefully makes sense, does good work, it is accurate, but there are no bounds and Kramer-Rao lower bounds and all those things. So that's what this does. I'm just thinking how many more pages are there. I think we're almost done, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll let me finish then. Okay, let me continue. So the received data is this. Signal of interest is S of n. And Sn is generated by some model which depends on the parameter of interest theta. So theta is the parameter of interest. And there is some S of n, there is some underlying signal. And somehow what I do is I receive this data y of n. This s of n is purely deterministic, so no probability, no models. And due to observation noise or model inaccuracies, we observe a perturbed version of s of n. So it's not that additive noise that we were talking about. So I mean, you have a certain s of n, but let me just see one thing. Anyway, basically this is what we would like to do, that j of theta, which is the objective function, this would be, we would like to minimize this, the value of theta that minimizes this is the LS estimator. So this is something that makes sense, that we would like to do this. In the MMSE case, we were looking at the average of this. But now, no averages, we just want to do this. And so because we did not really make any assumptions about Gaussian, non-Gaussian or any of that, so the method is valid for Gaussian, non-Gaussian, etc. But the performance of estimator will depend upon corrupting noise and modeling errors and so on, because we are not utilizing any description or any model of the noise. So we don't know, we are just doing something that makes sense and hope that it does well. So those are some things that in our lives we do, I mean, that without any models or anything, we just have to decide on something that maybe we want to attend this course. That's one of those decisions that you made without knowing what the
something and get the best answer. That's what you want. So, an example here is you take this is your signal A, you observe variance, so we take N samples, and estimate A by minimizing this. Notice there is no expectation or anything. We take the derivative with respect to A, set this equal to 0, and this is nothing but the sample we estimate. ML, maximum likelihood, also gave us the same result, same thing. But here we did not utilize any and so on. And if y of n was a plus wn, then the d squared estimator will also be nvdv. So under proper assumptions, this estimator that was derived without using any model or anything, it is MVUV. That's kind of interesting, but again, Gaussian, some under nice estimates. Gaussian makes life much, quite easy. So that is why we end up using Gaussian estimates, I mean, distributions on the ground. Even kids, I guess, before even they go to kindergarten or nursery school, they Gaussians. Gaussians, everybody assumes and so on, but in many cases they are not Gaussians. In practice, distributions are, I mean, they could be non Gaussian. And we just make assumptions for analytical tractability and hope that modeling error is not. Yeah, basically you are, the problem that you are solving is given this data, what is the estimate? There is another set of data, yes. So we are not basing it on the statistical description, right? So in the case of other things, we the statistics was known and we used that. So the realization, the model characterized it. Here it is pure the data.
We don't know what we are estimating, what is the value of our estimate. So we are setting our BC signal.
It is the signal that you want to estimate. That gives you observations, there is something that you want to estimate.
But what you want means theta is equal to A, we are saying. But how do we know that we are setting SN? And that is equal to our what we are going to estimate.
That is the problem, I guess. The problem statement is that you want to estimate theta or A and based on the data that you get. So it's not that we are setting, I mean, here it is an illustrative example where we are saying theta is equal to A that you are trying to estimate. So I'm the waveform part I didn't touch. Waveform part I did not touch. I'm just saying there is a DC level somehow, which is equal to it, which I don't know. And I want to estimate that based on the data that I received.
We have to assume the observation as a constant.
We are assuming that the underlying signal or parameter is a constant.
But how can we get into that then? SL is that constant.
There is a problem that we are trying to solve where this is a notation where the underlying parameter is A. That's all. I mean, I'm not saying it's just that the problem is given to me and I'm told that it's a deterministic signal, DC level signal, a constant A. Here is the data, give me an estimate of that. So I didn't choose or I didn't do anything. The problem was given to the estimate through this. So what is the D squared estimator in this case? So the person who's solving the problem doesn't know what's going on. He or she is given the problem to do this. That's what one is.
Can you say we are having a bit bad information on the data?
Okay, so now you are getting into other things. If you have prior information, then you are saying that I know the model, da-da-da-da-da. So see then the other things that we did. So you get into that. So I guess under certain conditions, this will give you the LDU estimator. And then the next thing is that can we do a linear D squares? D squares that we did, if we constrain our estimator to be linear, then basically. This is what we are doing, that the SN, which was in the case of so the signal and the parameter have a linear relationship. Previously I said that SN was equal to A, but now it's a little bit more general, that it is parameter times H of N. And H of N is a known sequence. So in this, so basically make it a little bit more general. And the LS error is again J of theta, the quantity that you want to minimize, given by this. Then theta hat is here and minimum least squares error is here. So it's instead of saying SL was equal to theta or A, it's a little bit more that there is a sequence and which would be useful for some applications. This was for scalar parameters. Now if we have a vector parameter, so then theta is a vector of dimension p times 1, and h is a matrix of dimension n times p, so then s is h times theta. So this is the observations that I have, and it is the data that we are trying to get. Again, it is least squares. We are not using any models and all that. So it's just the least squares. But this is how the data is generated. This data S is being generated by theta somehow. And this is the relationship of the underlying system, the problem. The error J of theta, which is what you want to minimize, one can express it in, this is in the matrix form, but this is just the element wise finding the square y minus sn. The LS estimator from here to here is given by this. And then there are some fine points about can you find the inverse of matrices and so on. And then we will talk about the dynamic and all these things. Minimum LS error is given by. So this is the result
that one gets for the vector case, and it is all related to, like the scalar case we talked in a little bit more detail. Least squares, basically what you are doing is vectorially that you have a subspace S2 in two dimensions. The observation that you have is this Y, and then what you are doing is you are taking the projection of this on the subspace, and this is your S hat that you are getting. So you can look at it in a geometrical form, in a visualization as to what you are doing. It's so picture is there just so that you get a more visual idea of what we are doing or what is happening. I think what I'm going to do is I'll do this LMS, and then I'll stop for the day. And the last part, which is the applications part, then we'll pick it up tomorrow. That I think will be a good thing. So LMS, least mean square filter, this is something that is useful in adaptive filtering. So many systems that are out there, they use adaptive filters. In some case, I think it's one of the things that I'll do in security. Therefore, I think it mentions LMS, so that's why you know what LMS means. So what it does is that basically it produces least mean square of the error signal and uses stochastic gradient descent method. So basically you're trying to learn the system. So you have an input XL, this is the unknown system, and you want to estimate this H of N. So you observe Y of N. Basically it is the feedback here allows you to estimate this system H of N, and then you keep going. So it's and stochastic gradient descent, basically it's like you are trying to, if you're minimizing and it is a bowl, and then you are trying to get to the bottom of it through a certain gradient. So how you go, that is what gradient descent talks about. So goal is Hn is to be identified, and you want to do H hat of N. Observable signals are Xn, Dn, and En. So Xn is coming in, the Dn and En, I guess, output error. So based on these things, you try to run your filter. It keeps adapting, and you keep changing, and it's automated. And these are some of the details. And so filter weights, I mean, you're trying to estimate your H of N to minimize the cost function. And this is the mean square error that we have talked about. The gradient descent method basically is that you want to move in a direction which is, basically going towards the minimum. You're trying to move in that direction. And this adaptive filters, there are some books, I don't know if I have them as a reference or not. Which book? Aiken has some books?
Yes.
Aiken has it.
Adaptive filters,
basically any adaptive filter book will have this sort of thing. And here I guess that what this is trying to say is that over here it requires the knowledge of the cross covariance, and that may not be available. So then people in many cases they just do this just based on the data, and that is to realize that it is an approximation, and then finally you get the estimate. So that's adaptive filtering is something that is used in cases. I didn't mean to include it too much, but
it's I think something on day four, I think, refers to LMS. So that's why now I'll be able to say, you know, LMS. So what we did we ran through a lot of estimation problems, a lot of estimation theory. Sometimes I went into detail, sometimes I just said, here is the result. But I hope you got the gist of it, because this whole thing that we did, typically if I'm teaching in a course, it probably will be several weeks of teaching. And I tried to compress it in whatever, 3.5 hours or so, which is quite a challenge for you and us. But I hope you were able to get the main ideas. So there were like, we had Bayesian estimators, so probability based. Bayesian, when you know the prior, when you don't know the prior, what is the achievable performance? And then you, I mean, basically, this is an ML estimate is a non-Bayesian one. Then we said that, okay, if we constrain the estimators to be linear, then we did a number of them and just mentioned this in passing, I guess. So what I will do is probably stop here, and tomorrow when we pick up, then we will see, say that, okay, look, we now know the estimation, how we do it. Then just touch upon some applications, how it was used, because that was one of the questions earlier, that saying that how will it be used, how do you find channel state information. So there may be a little bit of, I'll just tease you with it, I'll just indicate, yes, it is useful, but then going into details will be later. So I think I'll let you take over, and I think what we were going to do, the remaining folks that did not introduce themselves yesterday,